You know, among some of my colleagues at other conventions where they're into, say, lifestyle medicine only or plant-based diet, sometimes they become concerned about interventions that, or herbs or supplements, or the actual bioidentical hormone that restores to youthful levels. Yet there's a lot of evidence and research, but it is a leap of faith. You still at some point have to decide what therapy, you know, at the crossroad, what do you level? Want to add? At what level do you want to perform? And, right. and you know, and how is that going to translate into, you know, real life benefit? And so you and I have the benefit of seeing people do either. That sometimes they'll choose just, look, just give me the healthiest diet, exercise protocol, stress reduction, right. and love, social network. We right. know those things help right. the telomeres, right?
Right, and I'll take a multivitamin and a one plant-based, you know, polyphenol.
Right, right,
I'll
right.
do that. But that other stuff, that's voodoo, I don't want that.
Either. Right, right, right.
You do that, doc. Okay, you
know. Right, right. Right, or yeah. they'll limit their budget. They'll say, listen, sure. you know, here's my health, I'll spend more right. on my car upcake and my right. house uptake and yeah. my business.
You know, Nick, I'll always tell them, okay, yeah. you want the most bang for your buck, you got to start with all those basics that you and I know.
Right,
and
right.
Simple bang for buck basics. Sleep, get relatively good, high quality sleep, de-stress, get moderately strenuous, I think, exercise. Not just moderately strenuous exercise. Don't carry a spare tire. And you know, you and I had a very brief discussion. No, it was actually a more extensive discussion about what's the right diet. You know, I'm so simple. I really am. I'm a very simple human being. And I look at the human genome and I say, okay, 98.9% of our genes are all shared. So while I'm all for personalized medicine, and I believe in personalized medicine, especially with things like liver metabolism, drug metabolism, supplement metabolism, a lot of what we do is pretty broad brush and global and will work for a lot of people. Omega-3 fatty acids, there's not a lot of mosaicism or allelism in that. There's a need for this level of omega-3 fatty acids, this level of omega-6 fatty acids.
Dr. Dave, on that point,
yeah.
Can people use the algae for the vegan audience? Can they use the omega at a higher dose, I suspect, right?
It's a start. It's a start. And the problem, generally speaking, is...
Because they're saying there's a DHA-EPA ratio, right?
There's a ratio. There's a big difference in the ratios. And they could actually fix this, and I've told them how to do it. And basically, the problem is that you're going to have to waste a little bit of the product. You're going to have to sell the bottle of DHA and sell it to somebody else and just keep the EPA and DHA and concentrate that. And then... It's not a money-losing proposition. It could easily be done, but nobody's doing it.
Right.
Right now, they're just taking the sort of de novo algae and letting it do what it does. Cranks out 400 of DHA, 20 of EPA, so you have an imbalance there. Someone has definitely taken the genes and spliced them into bacteria and been able to use recombinant technology to have a bacteria crank out a reasonably balanced formula. But in the raw food vegan communities, that's looked at as GMO. You know, even though I don't consider it GMO, it is by a lot of people.
Right,
it's
voodoo
to those people. So right now, it's very difficult to get those people to the levels that you and I would consider healthy. But the algal stuff is a start. And if they won't take fish oil or some other marine-based thing, yeah, don't just do nothing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, don't just do nothing. And again, you can test these people. It's a simple finger stick test.
Well, I was going to say, Barry Sears does a fatty acid analysis.
Barry
was that Sears, the one you're referring to, or is
not
anyone
his,
else offer
the,
it?
Yeah, there's one out there called Ideal Omega, which we use. It was developed by Bill Lance, who is mm-hmm. the guru, the godfather. He's 85 or 86 now. He did all the original research.
Uh-huh.
It was probably the reason why Dr. Dyerberg went to Greenland was Dr. Lance's research. Although I don't think they would ever agree on that, but
I met Dr. Dyerberg just this year.
Yeah, and, fascinating guy, isn't he?
Yeah, yeah. He said the omegas would work. He said essentially that the fish get it from the algae anyway,
sure.
and they concentrate it. But that's the point. They concentrate it, and that's
exactly.
the difference. But then the problem with fish is sometimes the PCBs and
right.
the other concentrates, right?
And you wind up getting into this debate of triglyceride versus retriglyceride versus ethyl ester, and essentially it becomes and a less important, the biggest debate to me is, are you taking enough? You know, I have my preferences. I prefer ethyl esters because they're more studied. But, you know, I acknowledge that there are other forms out there and other people take them, including the algae-based stuff. The real debate to me is, are you getting enough to shift what's going on in your body, you know. And, you know, you remember the prostate cancer study that was released last year by Ted Brasky at the NCI, saying there was a 73% increase in prostate CA based on higher levels of omega. That one, it went to, Dr. Brasky's study was looking at people who were between 22%, that was considered low, and 25%, that was considered high. Okay, so he was differentiating 3% as being meaningful, which it's not. And in addition, I want people at 60%, not 25. 25 is still abysmally low to me. So all his study showed to me was that if you're low on omega-3s, you're going to get prostate cancer.
Wow.
You know,
good
that's
point.
What that study showed me. Mm-hmm. You know, so there's a lot of debate in that field. But I mean, I think it's a seminal thing to do for anti-aging. I think getting your omega-3 levels up, however you choose
right.
to get them.
Then you were going to point two. I cut you off.
No, that's okay. I think point two, you know, some of the other things in terms of like
Imports.
Sleep and that mm-hmm. kind of thing and measurements. I believe in doing sleep studies. I think there's a lot of people out there that are sleep apneic that don't know it, especially those people who are maybe mild to moderately obese. You know, 20, 30 pounds, which in our society is mild to moderately obese. I can't tell you the number of sleep apneas I've picked up like that.